everyone. I'm Norman Wildberger. Welcome to this series on the sociology of mathematics, where we try to delve in to the social aspects of pure mathematics. And we're doing this in order to understand mathematics better and to shed light on the direction and the challenges that face our discipline. So let's start out by having a definition of sociology. According to the internet, one source, it's the study of human social relationships and institutions. And we're interested in, how about a sociology of pure mathematics? Now this is of course challenging because math and sociology are quite far apart. Math is very abstract, difficult, okay? There's no question about that. And so it's not so easy for someone to have enough understanding of mathematics and also skill in sociology to be able to delve into this discipline and to pare it open and to uncover the social mechanisms working inside it. Would this be disruptive? Probably, because sociology tends to be that way. It tends to try to get in and take what people think are their aims, their idealisms, their lofty objectives, and sort of pare them down and say, well, what's happening here is actually more a reflection of innate human tendencies that we find in lots of other disciplines and groups as well. So it may be a little bit threatening, okay, but I think it's really interesting, and as we'll see, it's really important. If you're a social scientist and you're listening to this, you probably think, well, there's probably not a lot of scope because mathematics is so cut and dried and logical. There surely can't be a lot of room for division of opinions and, you know, differing actual interpretations of the actual mathematics itself. But that turns out to be, interestingly, not so true. So there are differences of opinion, and I think they are increasingly very important. So let me give you one really good example, which is concerning a fundamental theorem on the subject, the fundamental theorem of algebra, which in this context we'll say is the statement that if you have a polynomial, that it can be factored a certain way. So here's an example. Here's a polynomial of degree 5, 361 plus 238x minus 167x squared minus 39x cubed plus 7x to the fourth plus x to the fifth. And here's a graph of it obtained with the help of my computer. Note that the scale is from minus roughly 2,000 to 5,000 here in the y direction, from about minus 10 to 10 in the x direction. And we see that geometrically that the curve seems to cross the x-axis in 5 points. So those are the zeros of this polynomial. And in mathematics, we learn that those zeros are associated to linear factors. So the statement of the fundamental theorem of algebra in this context says that this polynomial ought to factor as a product of 5 linear factors, each one corresponding to one of these zeros here. Now, my claim is that, in fact, the reality of the situation is that this polynomial does not factor into a product of linear factors. It doesn't. So there's a divergence of opinion here. I have a different opinion on this factual matter than almost all my fellow pure mathematicians. Well, maybe I'm wrong. How are we going to decide? Are we going to appeal to authority? Do I have to list, you know, my accomplishments and then try to weigh them against somebody else? Are we going to have a debate where we fling, philosophical discussion back and forth? If you're a sociologist, you would probably think, well, this is mathematics. Surely we can decide something like this without debating. We just look at the mathematical statement and see whether it's true or not. If someone claims that this thing has a factorization into 5 linear factors, then let them exhibit those factors, then we'll check that that's actually correct, and then it will be clear that Wildberger is wrong and he has to retract his claim. But that's not going to happen, because nobody is able to actually come up with this factorization. And most pure mathematicians will at some level admit this, but they will not put two and two together. They will not go from that admission to the idea that the fundamental theorem of algebra actually is not exactly correct. Now, interestingly, the statement still has a lot of importance, and it has a meaning in an applied sense. Okay? In an applied sense, in other words, in an approximate setting, you can obtain approximate zeros, and you can approximately factor this thing. And that can be very important, say, for an applied mathematician who's looking at some eigenvalue problem. Maybe this is the key computation that underlies an eigenvalue problem. It actually has physical consequences. And the point is that the applied mathematician doesn't need an infinite decimal representation of these zeros, just five or six decimal places. It's likely all that they need. So they only are concerned with the truth of the theorem up to a certain level of approximation. That's very different, however, from the pure mathematical statement, which is an absolute statement with no errors whatsoever. So we have a divergence of opinion here, and in fact there is a whole range of other theorems that I could exhibit in this same direction. So we have a fork in the road, a parting of ways, and it's therefore interesting to analyze, you know, what's happening here. What are the reasons for people being oriented this way or that way? What are the social forces, the pressures and such that orient people in one direction rather than another, or maybe some third or fourth direction. Okay. So there is actually a very strong foundational reason for division, and it comes down to early 19th century difficulties with the foundations of mathematics, where at that time there was a huge amount of controversy, which has since been sort of subdued and is generally not talked about. But nevertheless, pure mathematics used to be a very controversial subject. And I think that's part of the interest of this story. The fact that, you know, controversy kind of ebbs and flows. And right now we're in a period of everyone more or less toeing the line and not really wanting to delve into the difficulties, the foundational difficulties represented by this kind of point of view. So here are some questions that can be asked to sort of provide an initial orientation to this exploration of the sociological aspects of mathematics. The first one might be, what is pure mathematics? And what are its origins? Where is the history? And where is that history taking us? Is the situation changing? Or is pure mathematics more or less set in stone in terms of, what it actually is? Well, I'm going to be explaining to you that actually pure mathematics is a relatively recent subject, and that the vast majority of mathematics throughout history has been essentially applied mathematics. So pure mathematics is really something which is still being developed. It's not a final discipline. Okay? It's still actually in its sort of early stages in some sense. So it's not surprising that there is actually attendant difficulties with its actual fundamental nature. Is pure math part of science? This is such an interesting question, okay? And there's there's things to be said in both directions. But I think both the parallels with science and also the differences with science are really important to keep track of. How do pure mathematicians think? How do they relate to each other? That's very interesting from a psychological point of view and, interactions, relations. What are the assumptions and beliefs underpinning the subject? Are there assumptions and beliefs, or is it all entirely logical? Well, actually, there are very strong assumptions and beliefs, but they're not usually framed in that way. But they actually are there, and they influence so much of modern contemporary pure mathematics. So much so that I might even suggest that students, undergraduates, learning mathematics, part of their training consists of being almost indoctrinated in thinking about foundational issues a certain way and not in opposing ways. This is great stuff for a sociologist to explore and to investigate further. What's the hierarchy? Sociologists look for power structures, for order, How do people organize themselves? Who's controlling things? This is always going to be important. It's important in mathematics too. And what role do journals and editors play? Very practical and important subject if you're actually a working mathematician or a student on the way to becoming a working mathematician. The role of journals and editors and referees has been always really central. And interestingly, it's shifting, I think, slowly but surely, and partly due to the effects of things like YouTube. You know, the world is changing, and the underlying publication landscape is also changing in pure mathematics. So these are just some of the issues that we're going to touch base with in this discussion. So sociology, I think, really is a kind of a disruptive science, and I'd like to position it perhaps this way, simplistically, that it's concerning itself with groups, and the groups are made of individuals. Individuals are more the study of psychology, and the groups themselves are embedded in cultures, which is maybe more the field of anthropology. So sociology is perhaps adjacent to psychology and anthropology, but it's mostly concerned with groups and the internal workings of groups, and also, you know, how groups interact with each other. And there are all kinds of aspects and questions and things to understand, including here's a whole bunch of things: class, demographics, power, identity, ethnicity, age, gender, order, deviance, norms, relationships, beliefs, behaviors, dress, emblems, fluidity, cooperation, competition, struggle, ideology. These are just some words that sort of occur to me as aspects of the question. Struggle, you know, do groups change dramatically? Is there a kind of uniformity of evolution, or do we actually have abrupt changes where things change the landscape dramatically? So I think there's a lot to be investigated. So I'd like to end by saying that, okay, I'm not a sociologist. I'm inviting people to think about this topic. I'm going to be presenting sort of my point of view on various things, but that's only one point of view out of very possibly many others. So hopefully others will contribute with information and stories and points of view. But I'd like to finish with three general claims that I have that I think underline the importance of this general inquiry. First claim is that actually I think in pure mathematics, social forces are more important in terms of directing the discipline than in applied mathematics or most of the physical sciences. In applied mathematics, in the physical sciences, there are often external, objective criterion or challenges that have to be met. And they naturally direct the disciplines in certain directions. Pure mathematics is more introspective in that sense. And it's, I think, really more directed by actual social forces in terms of the leadership and the power structure and which way that is directing the investigations. Another claim that I make, which I do so, somewhat painfully, is that I think that over-specialization is a big problem and that orthodoxy is also a big problem. And these two things, they limit the research vibrancy of the subject. I think, overall, and there are many exceptions, of course, but overall there's a feeling of, all these people doing small things that it's hard for other people to understand. There's not a current of important directions that everybody sort of acknowledges. I think we're painting ourselves into corners. And there's a lot of research being done, but it's not clear to me that people are really totally happy doing this research. I think there are more important questions that are looming out there. And associated with that, educational progress. I mean, I think there are all kinds of challenges having to do with the education of young people in mathematics. And I think that's primarily actually a job for pure mathematicians to think about. We should be thinking about that. And we should be aware that the logical limitations of our own discipline are going to filter down to the education of young people. In other words, if we don't get the right way of thinking about our subject, then it's going to impede the motivation and the progress of young people. And I think that's exactly what's been happening. That's a major contributor to the fact that mathematics, generally speaking, is not valued as an incredibly interesting and valuable and fabulous subject to learn about. And finally, a storm on the horizon that's coming towards us very quickly, okay, that almost nobody is talking about. We are totally unprepared for a coming onslaught of AI machines or programs. I'm sorry, but pure mathematics, that landscape is going to be changing dramatically in the next decade or two. Maybe it takes a bit longer, I suspect not. I suspect that even in 10 years, this will already be well on its way. And the consequences are going to be dramatic in terms of shifting and reorienting this discipline, which has been, continuously evolving for centuries, in fact, thousands of years. And it's going to be hugely disruptive. So I think it's really time is pressing, and we need to have a conversation about pure mathematics, the direction that it's going, and what we're going to do when the AI machines start knocking on our doors. Very, very important subject. So I hope you're going to be joining me for a lot of interesting discussions. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.